Chupacabra!
Missed out last week.
Yeah, we did.
We should sing this sometime.
No.
People say they have seen the chupacabra. After some tequila, he was dancing the lambada. We don't know where he has come from, making all the Mexicanos looky like a dum-dum. They say that he's a monkey. I think the whole story's just a little monkey.
There's a monkey-eyed creature that we call the chupacabra. 4 feet tall like a mutant chihuahua. In Mexico City, Puerto Rico, Nicaragua. Hey, chupacabra.
Wow.
Hay un criatura que se llama chupacabra. Es muy feo como chivis para mamá. Leemos pasar algunas palabras.
Chupacabra.
Brilliant. Back by popular demand and forever the intro to this show, the Chupacabra theme is by far our favorite and most requested of all the themes we've ever used. Welcome to everyone who can hear the sound of my voice to this week's edition of the Squatchable Podcast, where this week we actually have some Bigfoot news at the top of the show. And not just the obvious one either. We have two Bigfoot stories. Joining me this week, back from his hiatus in Washington State, Phil.
Okay. Yeah, I'm feeling much better now.
Good-o. From the Ulster Defense Initiative, Kevin.
Hello, how awfully nice.
From the swamps of Louisiana, Chubbs.
Greetings to everyone.
And from a Lancashire pig farm, Nikki.
I knew that shit was happening. Hey, everybody.
If you enjoy Nikki, Kevin, Chubbs, or Power Breakdown, you may enjoy the badly drawn misadventures of two Bigfoot. Head on over to Bigfoot with Keith and Colin, where this week Keith and Colin will desperately attempt to escape their stick figure existence after offending the artist last week. If you haven't looked at last week's cartoons, I'm very angry with you. They are. They were all brilliant. I am a humble genius. We're also introducing a new character this week called Deadfoot, and it's going to be a laugh. So,
you offended Prince?
What?
Prince, the artist?
No, I'm offended.
Oh, you're offended. Okay.
I am offended if you didn't look at last week's cartoons, Phil.
No, I did. I look at it all. I saw the one this morning with Patty in it.
I saw that one too.
Yeah.
Okay. So, well, yeah. Nikki and Chubbs always like them. So, you know, just saying.
Oh, wow.
Listen. If you go back and look, there's a laugh on everyone I've ever looked at.
I know.
Three of them that have laughs on them. I was kidding.
No, come on, man.
Anyway,
it's not about the artwork, it's about the content. The content, and it's great stuff. It really is.
That sounds like a guy who used to buy Playboys. It's about the articles.
It's about the articles. Yeah.
Well, in any case, I really enjoyed last week's cartoons. They filled me with joy. Without further ado, I am your host, Richard Judas Allen. Let's move on to our great Bigfoot stories. Our first story comes from Oklahoma. Oklahoma Republican introduces bill to create Bigfoot hunting season. The state's Department of Wildlife Conservation has since commented on the representative's unusual bill. Oh, that's not Republican, that's representative. Just said rep. My bad. An Oklahoma lawmaker has pitched a bill to create a bona fide Bigfoot hunting season in the Sooner State. The Sooner State. Is that really Oklahoma?
Yes.
Yeah. Tiger King and the Sooner State. Man, they really suffer. So on Wednesday, Justin Humphrey introduced House Bill 1648, urging the Oklahoma Wildlife Conservative Commission, or the OWCC, that rolls off the tongue much nicely, to establish a Bigfoot hunting season. The commission shall set annual season dates and create any necessary... what happened there? Any necessary specific hunting licenses and fees. It is a real bill, yes. Micah Holmes, Assistant Chief of the Information and Education Division at the Oklahoma Department of Wildlife Conservation confirmed to Fox News on Thursday. I'm not having a good day.
You guys might not know this. You can't laugh at him because in reality, Richard doesn't know how to read. He memorizes this stuff as he goes and he sounds it out phonetically. So
there is no teleprompter here.
That's the way I have to do it.
Well, anyway, there you have it. Oklahoma introducing Bigfoot hunting season.
That's not the whole story. The whole story is that the bill, if you read the bill, actually is a plea to establish rules for such a hunting season and not actual bill for the hunting season by itself. That would have to go through the Department of Natural Resources and so forth. But yeah, the idea is still, I don't know how much I can read between the lines, but it looks like it's a deadpan deal for killing Bigfoot. That's what it looks like to me.
Well, yeah, but the way I look at it is you know, like anything, I mean, everybody was making a big deal about it because they said, well, that means they're going to make us pay for research. And no, they're going to make you pay for killing it, you know?
Right.
You can go out and take a photograph of a deer right now. I mean, it's not against the law to do that. You just can't pop it.
Yeah, you don't need a license for that.
Yeah. So I don't know why people are saying that this is going to be some big thing. I mean, you know, what is it? It's a tax, you know, that's wrapped up in a fee. But at the same time, you know.
If you want your Bigfoot tag, you're going to have to pay for that tag.
Right. And I think a lot of people actually will buy that. I mean, you know what?
Just to say they have one.
Yes, exactly. That they want to hang that on the wall that says, I have a Bigfoot tag from Oklahoma. You know what I mean? There'll probably be an online thing where you can buy it and just go. I mean, that's what I would do. Right.
This raises an interesting question, actually. As we know, there are people that like to dress up as Bigfoot and hang around the woods and scare people, either for YouTube clicks or just for the hell of it.
And then get run over by two women in Montana.
Right. But people still do it for whatever reason. If you've got one of these Bigfoot tags and you shoot someone in a Bigfoot suit, does that like count as a Bigfoot body? Or
no.
Trouble, do you think?
No, it'll be accidental shooting.
Yeah.
But they'll have a tag.
Well, they better, and the big guy in the Bigfoot costume better have an orange vest on, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, but for real, if you've got a tag and someone dresses up as a Bigfoot and gets shot, surely that's on the person who dressed up as a Bigfoot.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, especially during Bigfoot season.
Well,
during Bigfoot hunting season.
I mean, even in the case of an accidental discharge, if you shoot somebody, it's basically manslaughter if you didn't mean it. You know what I mean? You can accidentally discharge your weapon and shoot somebody and kill them. I mean, that does happen where some guy's sitting in his front room of his house trying to sights at his optics. And then next thing you know, he's pumping around.
There have been cases where there have been people out hunting that did not have orange vests on that were accidentally shot because the person thought it was a deer and the person who shot got off.
Basically. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying in those cases, you know, that's a different matter. But what I'm saying is in that case where you could definitely say, for example, I had no clue that was a human. There was a human being there
inside that costume.
Yeah. And at that point in time, you'd have to say, yeah, probably you're right. You're not going to get, but it depends on your state too. You know, it depends on your locality and whether you did it. I mean, you know, it's a totally different thing to be out in the woods and shoot something than being in your neighborhood and shooting, you know, if you live in the city or whatever.
Yeah. It really wouldn't come across that kind of a scenario in downtown Detroit.
Well, you never know.
Well, that's true.
Hmm.
Hey, he's got his Bigfoot tag.
He's going
hunting.
Well, if he was dressed up like a Crip, there would be a lot of maybe.
Chubbs, what do you reckon?
I think it's a obviously publicity stunt type thing, but it's a good example of we could do something to say we need to use the time, money, and effort to actually establish this said cryptid, and then you can make these ridiculous rules later. But, you know, they still, it's still a joke, kind of, you know, in pop culture. You know, you see the beef jerky commercials, and there's a Bigfoot, whatever. When
no, I think this guy was serious, though. I think he's freaking dead serious. It's a real asshole, too.
Yeah, but I think we could use that as an example of, okay, he's mocking us in a way, because, you know, they believe it or not, but if they could just do something, like, we all know that scientists can't help us because they're going to be laughed at if they listen to us. That's the way I look at it. We could use this for a better purpose. I think it's just terrible, I guess.
Yeah, well, that's true.
Yeah. I did send an email to Denver Riggleman, and he never contacted me back. So we don't know what West Virginia's stance on it is.
Okay.
Alrighty. So that's the first Bigfoot news over with. The other Bigfoot news.
And don't shoot Bigfoot, people. Please, if you see one, don't shoot it.
Phil is vehemently on the no-kill border of this.
I am on the no-kill. Sorry. Had to say that.
Yeah, no. It's a point worth making. If they do exist, please don't kill them. Even for science.
Especially for science.
Anyway, moving on. Our next Bigfoot story is, of course, the developing story that Matt Johnson has indeed lost his freaking mind. Now, every time...
What do you mean has?
Yeah, I mean, every time, every year, it seems, this man gets crazier and crazier. Every time I think, well, this is it. He can't possibly say anything more insane. He just proved me wrong. You know, he is a man who has both proved me right and proved me wrong at the same time.
Have you not thought about not challenging him?
Not challenging him?
Yeah.
What, just ignoring him?
Well, no, I mean, you say, can he get any more insane? And he's like, challenge accepted.
I suppose.
Maybe this is all your fault.
Maybe.
I think that's a cabal of crazy. I don't think it's just him. There's people that are backing him up.
He has surrounded himself with yes men, which is a typical cult maneuver.
Well, he's got the type of personality where he's got to one-up himself.
Mm. That's very true. Anyway, last week, before the inauguration, and we're not going to get into that, it's either a good thing or a bad thing, but last week, before the inauguration, he made a video about, basically ranted into the camera about holding people accountable, because he was absolutely convinced that what he said was going to happen was going to happen, which was the National Guard was going to arrest Biden. And the emergency broadcast system was going to enable Trump was going to be president, and the country was going into martial law. He was absolutely convinced of this. And whether you wanted that to happen or not, we're not going to venture an opinion. Anywho, it obviously didn't happen. And during this video, he ranted into the camera about this and said specifically that he was going to hold people accountable for what they had said. He was going to hold everybody that doubted him accountable, and he was going to say, you better apologize to me and not move the goalposts, because that'll show that you've got no integrity. He has since taken this video down, but I did a blog about it.
And his goalposts.
And yeah, well, we're getting to that.
Okay. I'm going to jump back. Yeah, no, go ahead.
We're getting to that. Since then, the inauguration happened without a hitch. President Trump is now ex-President Trump. President Joe Biden is the sitting president. No National Guardsmen attempted to arrest him. The emergency broadcast system didn't activate. And QAnon were revealed to be the bunch of insane human beings that they are. And I'm going to stand by that regardless. Anyway, he went silent. He went absolutely silent. For two whole days, he didn't say a single word, not on his page, not anywhere that I could find. This morning, he posted this. Deer will be your sign, Zorth. And Zorth has less credibility than Matthew Johnson at this point, but whatever. Yesterday, I was bouncing around within the principle of one-third, one-third, one-third. I asked Zorth if Trump still wins in the end. He responded in his usual short and sweet manner, "Yes, and deer will be your sign." At that exact moment in time, while I was driving to work, a large buck ran across the road right in front of my F-150 truck. Whoa! During the day, I saw 8 clients. In between psychological counseling sessions, I would check my posts and PMs. Some people were in the first third.
Now, let's make this clear. He's the one giving this.
Giving the session.
Yeah, yeah. He's not the one. He's not the one going.
All right.
Some people were in the first third and were very positive and encouraging. Some people were in the next third and were understandably wrestling with doubts and assurances. Finally, the last third were a bunch of whiners, accusers, haters, and trolls. Basically, anyone who did not agree with my worldview. On my way home from work, once again, I was wrestling with this principle of three-thirds, too. I asked Zorth, does Trump still will in the end? He responded, yes, and deer will be your sign. Once again, this is the second time this is happening, even though I am word perfect from the first paragraph. A large buck ran across the road right in front of my F-150 truck. Double whoa. Not to be outdone. While driving home from work tonight, Cynthia had 3 deer run by her Subaru within a half mile of our home. Those of you who are familiar with my videos and books will know that Zorth has used deer as a sign on numerous occasions. Trump will in the end eat some popcorn. Cynthia and I are eating popcorn as I type. Basically, he has had no accountability for his insane posts and he has moved his bait. Goalposts, and I feel like that was worth commenting on. Plus, he's nuts, gentlemen and ladies. Your thoughts?
Well, you know, there's no way that a deer you'd see a deer anywhere in Washington State. That's just way out of bounds. I mean, it had to be true, right?
Well, he probably did see a deer, but let's look at it this way: he lives on property that he owns 2 parcels of land on that are 5 acres each. And that's 10 acres. And then everybody else around him has a 5-acre parcel because that's how it works out in the counties around here, right?
Now, I'm never sure with Phil. I'm never 100%, but I'm 98% sure he was being sarcastic.
No, I understand. I understand what. No, I'm saying that too. I mean, you know,
living right here in the middle of Marysville, and you know what I'm talking about. When we first moved into this house, we could not keep the deer out of the freaking yard. You know,
right? And if you go to Ocean Shores, which I believe which is kind of where his practice is around that area, you can literally they say slow down. Because you're going to kill, you know, like a deer is going to mess your car up. I mean, not seeing a deer is probably more indication of a sign.
That brings up another point. He says, deer will be your sign. Well, there are signs of deer crossings everywhere along the road.
Mm-hmm.
How do we know he didn't mean that?
Well,
there's your sign.
The thing that, I mean, I don't want to
get the only one that thought that.
Here's the thing. He is not and I've said this before, this is all somebody else's doing. This is not Zorth and it's not Dr. J that's coming up with it. If you are not got nothing to do with Bigfoot and you just want to get into conspiracy theories, there are people out there who believe the exact same thing as him. So this has nothing to do with Matt Johnson in a way. He's promoting it. He's promoting it, but he is a cult member of somebody else.
Don't call your team squatching and talk about this though.
It's interesting if you notice a lot of the things that he incorporates into his belief system comes from other belief systems.
Right.
I get what you're saying, Chubbs. You're saying don't bring political stuff into a Bigfoot group.
Well, right. That and don't use what you call yourself as like I'm on the council. I talk to Bigfoot, and then don't bring anything else than Bigfoot. Like he could help the millions of guys and girls trying to research the Bigfoot phenomenon. In that, but no, he's the you know, the world leader on their council, and I'm trying to be fair to the guy, but
why?
Because I'm one of the people, like, if he's charging money and asking people to come clean his house, what's that got to do with Bigfoot, man? He puts up pictures of, like, dust in the air and goes, look, Zorth. And it's like, ah, come on. You can do better than that.
Yeah, that comes from the ghost hunting people. And,
I think we've broken Chubbs, man. He's ranting.
Yeah, but Chubbs has some real points there. I mean, if you look at what he could be doing instead of doing this political crap, he could say, Zorth came to me last night. It's the Christmas season, and he's encouraging everyone to give to the Salvation Army because they do good things. But he doesn't. Instead, he goes the opposite direction.
Yeah, it's all self-serving. It's all grandiosity. But Chubbs did bring up a really interesting point. Matthew Johnson claims to be the 13th member of the Council of 12. Surely that means he's privy to all the information the rest of them are. Why is Zorth having to tell him anything about Trump? Surely he should know this stuff already.
Aha!
Got him. Right, that's it.
Matthew Johnson. That's it. That's the trap right there.
Finally got him.
I'm not going to get into the intricacies of how that all came up, but I will say this, that the issue with Matt, if anybody follows his progression between his claims at every conference he ever had, because you can look it up, right? What happened to it? They get more and more and more outrageous. And that's the thing. And now, just because we can't have a conference right now, doesn't mean that we wouldn't have one. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Explaining how this is all all this thing. But it's clearly his viewpoint that that something wrong has happened based on that. But do not bring in, and I've always said that, do not bring in somebody else that you see. But you see this with spiritual people. Now, this is the thing where you find out yoga people are into QAnon, and people who channel things are into QAnon, and people who are anti-vaxxers are into QAnon. So you do get this weird mix of people who have gone down that road for one reason or another. And, and in all seriousness, because whenever I was growing up, you could say I was in a bit of a political cult growing up in Northern Ireland, and you didn't listen to anybody else. You didn't listen to the other side. You didn't want to hear what they said. Don't listen to anything that they had, what they had to go and say. They're the bad ones. They're the baddies. And so in order to get out of that, somebody has to actually say, when you come back to reality, we love you. You know what I mean? It's going to be all right. And that's what I'm going to say is, if you believe that, but don't go to the next extreme now. And I think that that's one of the things that you're talking about. Now I believe that they're talking about the fact that he's going to he's going to be put back in office, That's not how it works constitutionally. That wouldn't happen that way. But the thing that's true about it is that they are completely moving the goalpost, and he hasn't given up on the idea. Clearly,
that was my point. He's had no accountability for his claims, and he's moved the goalpost after ranting about it. But he's taken a video down now, and I didn't bother to download it, so it's gone forever. Shame. I should really start downloading his really stupid videos.
No.
Anyway. Yeah, I don't want that on my hard drive. All right. So we've ranted enough about Bigfoot. Phil, Cadaverosaurus.
Yes, a local myth. And, I'd say local as in British Columbia, all the way down the coastline to and including Oregon State. And it's not really, if you look at like Nessie, I don't know why people compare it with Nessie, because Nessie is more like kind of a saurus, cryptid, whereas Cadaverosaurus is not necessarily a source. It's more along the lines of the old mythical sea serpent mythologies. So anyway, let's read this here. There's many cryptic creatures, and the entire field of cryptozoology is dedicated to their study. By definition, a cryptid is, of course, an animal whose existence is questionable. Within the waterways of the Pacific Northwest in America, one such creature, described as a giant plesiosaur-like serpentine animal, has confounded witnesses for at least 100 years. Its name is Cadborosaurus. Although there have been 200 to 300 reports, Caddy, not unlike the Loch Ness Monster, which I disagree with this, has proven elusive. Unfortunately, there is no hard evidence of this sea creature. However, the possibilities are intriguing, albeit endless. Is the cryptid some kind of undocumented sea serpent, a relic from the age of dinosaurs, or just a mythological fabulation, is what he put in here. I think you meant fabrication. So, mariners, they have reported sea serpents for thousands of years, as we all know. There are lithographs and stuff of this nature. But nearly all cultures around the world have embraced its mythology in one form or another. However, Cadborosaurus is specific to the American Northwest and its waters. This mega serpent purportedly making, I have a hard time with that word,
purportedly.
Thank you very much, Nikki. Makes appearances off the coast of Canada, in British Columbia lakes, around Alaskan waters, and as far south as, well, this is something I didn't know, San Francisco and Monterey Bay in California. Even the Inuit report of a similar creature. So what does it look like? Well, it's named for numerous sightings in Cadboro Bay in Victoria, British Columbia. Caddy descriptions vary widely. In general, the adults are up to 40 or 50 feet in length, while the juveniles are 10 to 15 feet. They have, oh, by the way, there's another one, which is a baby, a newborn caddy, which I will talk about in a moment. They have slender, scaly, elongated bodies like a large lizard or giant eel. In fact, cryptozoologists have classified the sea serpent as a reptile and believe it may be relic of the age of the dinosaurs, perhaps a plesiosaur, which I disagree with. Its head looks like a camel or sheep or horse, and it almost always possesses fins or flippers, little baby flippers. However, the number of fins, their location, and their descriptions differ. Some witnesses have indicated that the rear fins seem to lead to a tail that fans out. Now, there are black and white photos from 1937 showing a long creature that fishermen had pulled out of the stomach of a whale near the Queen Charlotte Islands. At that time, experts sent out tissue samples to the BC Provincial Museum for testing. One of the samples became lost. Mysterious music here. Experts tentatively deemed the other a fatal baleen whale. However, eyewitnesses say that there is no way that it could have been a feeding baleen whale, nonetheless, you know, inside of another whale. So nonetheless, cryptozoologists consider this photo of a Naden Harbor carcass shown below to be a compelling piece of evidence. I should have sent this to you.
Yeah. The one thing I will say about that too, Phil, and I don't know if it goes into it, but these people were whalers. You know what I mean? So rather than trying to, have somebody from a museum tell you what it is, I mean, hey, these guys are in the water every day killing whales. Do you not think they would know what a fetal baleen whale looks like?
Sure, I do. And I also know that they know how to lie.
Hey, yeah,
that's true.
Yeah, lie all the time.
Absolutely.
They're known for it.
The photograph I should send that to you after I read this. Basically shows what to me looks like the remnants of a whale. You know, there are certain portions of the whale that do not dissolve readily in salt water. I mean, even after the bones have, you know, fluffed off and so forth, they have this very sinewy center tissue that remains, and it takes on its own kind of a strange shape. And people had brought these tissues from whales ashore, you see them hanging off the sides of ships and so forth, and claiming it to be some kind of a sea serpent or something. But anyway, that's just where I'm at on it. Anyway, in the 1990s, Edward Blofeld, not to be confused with, you know,
the James Bond character,
unless he was a zoologist, and Paul LeBlanc, an oceanographer, took an interest in Caddy. They compiled and studied hundreds of reports, photos, and specimens of lake creatures and sea serpents. Additionally, they classified a new species for Caddy and called it Cadborosaurus wilsi. In 1995, the two men published Cadborosaurus, Survivor of the Deep, in a book. As quoted by Coleman in Ed Blofeld, The Daring Zoologist Dies, they give a systematic review of observations and analysis of biological characteristics of our elusive cryptid friend, which all is meaningless, I might add. So, I'm not going to talk about Blofeld. he's an evil genius.
What? Are you finished?
No. In 1968, Captain William Hegland caught something strange. He believed that it was a baby sea serpent. According to Hegland, it was 16 inches long with scales. It also had a tail like a flipper and two additional flippers on its body. Unfortunately, the captain tossed the creature back before anyone could photograph or study it. Additionally, it was years before he recounted his story officially. Blofeld and LeBlanc believe he had seen none other than Caddy. Which brings me to a more recent story about a woman up here in the San Juans who, while walking her dog along the seashore — this is not in the story, this is something that I remembered reading from years ago — and she came across what is said to be a baby, a newborn Cadborosaurus that had washed up on the shore. And it was roughly about 18 inches long. It was serpentine. It had a head that looked like a horse. And she thought, sure enough, this has got to be a newborn Cadborosaurus. And something interesting, though, when zoologists look at it, oceanographers, they looked at it, because obviously people are interested in this sort of thing. It is rare to find one of these pipe fishes on the shore, but that's what it is, a pipe fish. So anytime you hear the story about a newborn caddy washed up on the shore, and it does match the description other than the fact it's 18 inches long, then you will see that it is a pipe fish. Anyway, there are also some videos. If you look, just Google it, or go to your DuckDuckGo and see if you can find some interesting videos. There's videos all over the place. Some of these videos look like they're, let's say, some beaver in line with each other, or sea otters in line with each other playing around. You know, some look like it might be an actual whale, not Cadborosaurus. And it's very hard to say. Anytime something's in the water with some kind of its body protruding above the water, you can imagine anything underneath the surface. So let's get real with that one. But anyway, that's Cadborosaurus. It's our own little Nessie up here, if you want to go that way. And hey, it's ours. We claim it.
I think
I've got a video going.
What I think is interesting about it is, though, Phil, to be honest with you, when you see, and I think John Kirk the third or whatever, that guy, that's his main thing that he does now. He doesn't really do Bigfoot that much, but I mean, he's always out looking for these things. And the and he's claimed that he's seen at least two of them. But when he describes them, he describes them as having this undulating body, almost like it's not articulated side to side, but it goes up and down as well. And so that you can actually see underneath the body of the creature as it's going through the water. In other words, you literally see air underneath these humps. And what I will say to you is that's how, before the plesiosaurus aspect was brought into Loch Ness, that's how they were described. In other words, Colin Bannis was the first person who supposedly saw, which is an Irish guy coming from my neck of the woods, supposedly saw the Loch Ness monster in the River Ness. He didn't actually see it in Loch Ness, but that's how it's described. And in Scottish folklore, there is a thing called a Kelpie, which is a water horse, which has a horse's head, and basically, has this undulating body, and they drag you down into the water.
Interesting thing about water kelpies, you can beat them if you outrhyme them.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and so the thing that is interesting is that, and what I always find interesting is how these stories are sort of universal in a way, that you've got this creature. Now, I don't know what it is, and I don't know if it's real. I don't know anything. But, when you see depictions of sea monsters or sea snakes, that's something that's been around for a long time. So is that what we're imagining we're seeing or what? I mean, I don't know. Obviously,
well, yeah. Sailors have been around, since, 8500 or whatever, traveling the world, and they all carry, fantastic stories to enthrall the women of the locality of which they happen to be visiting at the time.
I wouldn't know anything about that.
Yeah, of course not. So of course these things spread around, and I'd say more so in the last, few hundred years than ever before.
Yeah.
And and with the advent of photography, it just ramps it right up. I sent you a photo.
I'm displaying it.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
But the good thing about it is that, the plesiosaur surgeon's photo, which was fake about the Loch Ness monster, was one of those reasons why I think a lot of people got led down that road, because that's the way it is. But clearly, when you look at creatures from around the thing, like Champy or whatever, or what's the one that's supposed to be up in that lake, the Okanagan Lake? Or something, there's some lake in the Okanagan that's supposedly
got. No, I know Champy from Lake Champlain.
Well, yeah, I know, but I mean, there's one. There's something.
Oh, Ogopogo?
Yeah, Ogopogo.
Oh, okay.
Is supposed to have that sort of characteristic. Mm-hmm. It doesn't mean it's real, but I mean, it just means that for whatever reason, people see these, tend to want to believe that they're there. But some people will swear by it, and like I said, but that doesn't make it. That doesn't make it real, but
yeah.
I think with water especially, you can make the claim that in an ocean there's something we don't know.
Well, I've in the North Atlantic, when I was doing the weather station in the Coast Guard, we'd see dolphins, and when dolphins leap from the water and then dive back into the water, make that half loop, you can see underneath them, for example, and they do tend to play in a line. Yeah. So if they're off in the distance and you see several of them jumping one after another, it does look serpentine. It looks like a sea serpent.
Yeah. Or if you've ever seen a flying fish, like come home and tell somebody you saw that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Thank God every day my parents weren't flying fish. Those poor things have the worst lives in the world.
One of them landed on our deck.
Yeah. See what I mean? They get chased out of the water by predators, picked up by frigate birds in the air or land on Phil's deck.
Right.
It's just the worst life being a flying fish. Chubbs, you got anything to say about the Cadbrosaurus?
Sure. I'll just come from the point of I live pretty much in and around water. I've been around it all my life. I wouldn't count out anything. Now, I've seen, you know, 10-foot snakes to 15-foot alligators in my life. Maybe misidentified some of these things, but, I mean, if there was a 20-foot eel, that is a sea serpent. So I wouldn't count anything out, but maybe I'd say misidentified. But the seas, the lakes, oceans, rivers are so vast. And, you know, every day somebody has a new catfish record. And, you know, so maybe not, you know, something prehistoric, but even something that we know is real to get a tremendous size is certainly not out of the question. It would be unbelievable. So I think people, you know, do see things. Some exaggerate, but some people see things so big they can't explain. So why not? I don't know about the horse's head deal, but, you know, a big sea serpent, I firmly will say, I believe probably does exist.
Nice. Nikki?
I actually had pretty much the same thing as Chubbs to say. I mean, we discover things in the sea all the time. Like December 2020, they found like some kind of sea blob or something they've never seen before. We've uncharted like most of the ocean and we don't know everything. So this is one of those where I'm like, depending on where you're seeing it and what the situation is, it could be that, or it could be exactly what Chubbs said and just be something that's gotten much bigger than what we're used to seeing. That's where I see, because I think that when it comes to the ocean, I mean, there's a lot of things that we know about, but there's also far more things that we don't know about.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, how long ago did we? I mean, we always had the idea of the giant squid, but we didn't actually prove it until very recently.
Yeah, just a couple years ago.
Yeah, and as far as that
squid, we've heard about them since the 60s. Dead one washed up on the beach. That's how we found out about them. You're talking about the colossal squid.
Yeah, whatever the thing they find down and
yeah, whatever.
The sea of Cortez.
It's whatever is completely different species.
Well, I don't know. I mean, like I said,
giant squid are torpedo and ambush predators. Colossal squid are built heavier; they're scavengers. All right, so let's
You're
just
such a sea nerd, Richard.
Let's get our squid species.
Was the Kraken?
The colossal.
Let's not get into politics again.
No. The science.
Kraken 2024.
Yeah, the colossal squid is the most Kraken looking of all the squids.
Yeah, well, that's what I mean. That's right. Yeah,
I'm just saying. You know, let's be specific when talking about
specific.
We're talking about cryptids and stuff, and
we're not talking about cryptids. We're talking about real animals now.
Oh, I forgot we were on the podcast. I'm not.
Why are you doing the voice on the podcast?
do it like the watcher if you're going to do it.
It's a colossal squid. Mike.
Well, anyway. Someone, I care about squid, okay? So let's.
Well, yeah, no, yeah, I never.
Obviously, you have a passion for them I didn't know about.
Yeah. That's it. We got a great aquarium.
All that Japanese hentai he's been watching, he's really fascinated with tentacles and.
Yeah.
Just went quiet.
I wasn't even going to dignify that with a response. Thank you, Phil. You didn't. All right. Anyway, now that we've plumbed the depths of the ocean and my sex life, apparently, we're moving on to our next topic. Before we do that, Planet Fear, Matt Knapp's new podcast, episode 4. It's a good show. It's a good laugh. Head on over to any podcasting platform to give it a listen. You know, I enjoy it. Has anyone else listened to it?
I haven't, to be honest with you.
It's a clever show.
I have to say that I didn't, but I will. I will. Okay. Since it's an ongoing thing, I think that I should, you know, I should listen to it because we talk about it every week.
Well, yeah, I sort of plug it every week. But, you know, give it a listen. It's a good laugh. We move on now to our final topic of the evening, Kevin's crystal skulls. And, you know, take it away, Kevo.
Okay, hold on. I just had, did you hear that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We don't own that, by the way.
I know we don't own that. I mean, I played that, and it's not copyright. Anyway, I just needed to put some disco in. Anyway. Yeah,
absolutely fine. You know, put your.
Even really, though it sucks.
You put your really terrible genre music into the podcast. I don't.
Yeah.
Go.
We just lost 4 listeners.
I actually. It was meant to be my wife talking about the crystals. I mean, this the story. But anyway, I'll play that later. But anyway, the Mitchell Hedges crystal skull is one of the things. It was kind of the one that started it all. You know, a lot of people actually sort of. It was found by this guy named Edward Mitchell Hedges. He was an English man, and you know, it's kind of the archetypal person that people think Indiana Jones is
modeled after.
It's based on, yeah. And so, like, you know, as far as the way that it went, he found this in the city of stone in the middle of British Honduras, which is now Belize, what he thought at the time was a pre-Mayan temple. What happened was is that they were led there, supposedly. There's 2 different versions of the story, depending on which one you read. The early version was that he was led there by natives who showed him the old place. And then there was, you know, later on account where he had basically hacked his way through the jungle and found it, you know, kind of on its own. So it doesn't start out great, to be honest with you, because there's 2 different written accounts of how he found this town. But he was there with his daughter, Anna Mitchell Hedges, and she was the one who supposedly found this crystal skull in 1924. And so the crystal skull, I've seen it. I've been around it. My wife's been around it. So obviously it's a real thing. You know, it's very, very, very interesting to look at. And because of the fact that it does seem to have these unique qualities about it. But so the story was that he found this crystal skull. It was supposedly, according to, you know, Maya people that were still there and old Maya lore, that this was called the skull of doom. In other words, it had this really negative connotation. So she was standing on this old pyramid that had basically fallen down into this temple, and so she was looking through the rocks, saw this gleaming thing caught in the sunlight, and so then everybody came over. And then found this skull, which was sort of this big cause celeb that everybody wanted to see it. It was sent to the British Museum, who had also had a crystal skull. And a sort of mythology of these crystal skulls started popping up all over the place. Now, obviously, crystal skulls, you could still buy them now. I mean, if you're in the spiritual new age thing, people, you know, have crystal skulls, they talk to them. But, and this is where the idea of the, you know, Indiana Jones 4 comes from, the crystal skull. That's that idea of finding that. But what's really interesting about it is that even though you can't date stone, you know, you don't know when it was formed, you don't know anything else. All you can do is look at it and say, you know, it's from here, because if you look at the occlusions of and the material, it does match quartz that was from the Central America, sort of Southern America type quartz that you find there. In other words, so it is the proper quartz. It also is carved out of one single piece of quartz or rock crystal. So that makes it even sort of more rare. It's not an amalgamation. It's nothing like that. It was one big piece of quartz that was found and shaped by people. Now, a lot of people say from that standpoint, well, they didn't have the technology to make that back then, so it can't be real. And so, you know, I think the last time they did a discovery, a show on it, was Destination Unknown with Josh Gates and Bill Holman. Bill Holman's the guy who now is the keeper of the skull. And I've met him several times. I know him pretty well. My wife knows him really well. But anyway, the interesting thing about it was is that they people say in the situations that that Mitchell Hedges bought it from somebody at a Sotheby's auction in 1945, which would be interesting on the fact that he wrote a book that says he found it in 1933. So, you know, can you, you know, this one of those things where there's a lot of problems with it, but then at the same time, you look at it from the standpoint of at a certain time going around to, you know, places in, you know, this Southern America and stuff, they kind of didn't like you going around nicking their stuff. And they started wanting their stuff back. So if he could come up with some story that he said he bought it from another guy, then it's not his problem. You know, he bought it through an auction, so it's his property at that point in time. It doesn't matter if it's pre-Columbian art and I have to send it back. So that's one thing I'd say about it. But now the other crystal skulls that people look at have pretty much figured out that it was made by this German manufacturer.
Aha!
Using,
never trust them Germans.
Well, you see what I'm saying? Like the interesting thing about it is there's supposedly these 13 skulls and everybody wants to do it, but the problem is that the majority of them have been proven to have sort of small tool marks on them and everything like that, whereas the other Mitchell Hedges skull, all they can say about it is that it was polished using a unidirectional polishing method. Now, you know, so they say, well, that was a wheel. Now, you know, the funny thing that I always say about that is so it's got to be a hoax because Mayans didn't have wheels, apparently. However, if you've ever watched a show on Mayans, Mayan calendars, Aztec calendars, how are they always described? Like a wheel. Three cogs, of course, have an axle that match together and go around time and can predict time to, you know, the nth degree and have the most accurate, you know, time dating system that was known at that point in time. So they also, you know, have ball courts with round circles in them where you put a ball through. So it's just ridiculous to me that somebody says they didn't have a wheel. Maybe they didn't have wheels on carts because they didn't have large oxen and things like that. There was no way to pull it. So there was no point in that. You know what I mean? But it doesn't mean that they didn't have or understand wheels. That's the first thing. The second thing that I'll say about it is that in 2018, they did a big, huge LIDAR survey of the jungle in Guatemala. Now, the Mayan Empire was southern Mexico, Guatemala, and parts of Belize, which, again, was British Honduras.
And the Yucatan.
Yeah, yeah, but yeah, the Yucatan, Yucatan Peninsula. But what I'll say about that is that once, so they due to what they had found, they thought, okay, well, there's probably 1 million people living in Guatemala as Mayans living in Guatemala. Once they did this LIDAR survey of that 800 square mile area, rather than having like 1,000 buildings, they realized that there were 60,000 buildings in the jungle, and these were huge, massive places, and they had to change the aspect of the size of the culture in that area from 1 million to 11 million. So basically, we don't know squat about Mayans. That's the truth, right? We don't know anything about it. And so we really don't know, based on a lot of different things, what they were capable of doing or not. Obviously, they weren't just trekking through the jungle. They must have had serious waterway usage to get that much food for 11 million people up and down waterways and stuff like that. So, you know, clearly we don't have that great of an idea of what they were capable of. It doesn't really matter, though, because in my opinion, a big, and I, you know, I'm going to go woo here on this. You can talk to me about it later. That's fine. But crystal in a huge amount like that has some kind of a property whenever you're looking at it. And so anyway, my wife was invited to go and see the skull. So she went down it, what she went down and saw it and met with Bill and everything like that, because he had recently come up with a different things that said that Mitchell Hedges had hidden other objects in South America, Central America, that they were trying to locate. One was a crystal deity, a little crystal boy figure. And so because my wife has a weird ability to find stuff that she's never been to, I mean, you know, it's weird. But anyway, because she has a way of connecting to something, I don't know what that's called whenever you know, put your hand on it and you know where it's been or something like that, or you can see through it or whatever. So she went down and touched it, and he said, I'm looking for this crystal deity. And so she basically said, this is where it's at. This is what you're going to have to do. I mean, she has all the texts and everything like that, which is bizarre. But anyway, she said, you're going to have to go to this cave, and you have to lower yourself into the cave. And these are the different types of things that you're going to see. And then that's where it'll be. That's just one of those things. Like I said, my wife, it's just, that's what she does, you know. And I've been around her enough to know that if I lose my wallet, I just have to ask her where it is. She finds it for me. But so whenever Josh Gates was going to do the show with Bill Holman, they used the information that she'd given them to try to find this crystal baby. Now, she at one point in time was supposed to go with them, but there was a lot of trouble with me because I know British Honduras or Belize is a major drug cartel area, you know, and they ship stuff up and down the river.
Yeah, it is now.
So, yeah, and you're not going to, you don't want to, you know, be in the middle of that. So there was a big stink in my family about her going, and I kind of put the poo-poo on it. But anyway, I had told them all this information. And so they went down and they found the cave, and they did have to follow the directions that she'd give them to get down into this location and find it. They found a pre-Mayan jug, you know, a big pot there. So they had to stop. They had to leave at that point in time because they'd actually found something. And they didn't get to see the rest of the cave because that's kind of how the archaeologist rules were. You know, if you find something, okay, you got to stop. So they did stop. But anyway.
Yeah, but if the locals got wind of it, they'd be back there in a second.
Yeah, well, that's the thing that's true. There's pirates in that area. There's all kinds of different things, so it was interesting anyway. So my wife may, you know, she doesn't talk about it very much.
She's part of the story though now.
Well, I know she is part of the story, but she doesn't talk about this ability that she has all the time because it's just a weird. It's a weird
stuff. Yeah, but the fact they listened to her, they actually went there, she's part of the exploration team.
Yeah. Well, they did mention her in the show, and I did say it. My wife's name is Samara, but we call her Sammy because the fact that I got to just try to find it. The fact that everybody calls her Samantha otherwise.
Yeah. I know this is going to run a little long, but do I have a turn in this one?
Yeah, go ahead. I mean, I'm going to look for this little.
Yes. So, now Mr. Hedges, he was quite a con man. He, his story changed a little bit. You have to go back to the source in this story, and according to him, he and his quote unquote team had been digging on the side of this pyramid for several months before coming across this opening and finding the skull. The interesting thing about this story is that he was on an expedition not led by natives, but by scientists and archaeologists, one of which was a Mrs. Brown. I don't remember what her first name is. And records were kept by the archaeologists. Every little detail, every little item that was found at the site was documented in the journals. Not one mention of any crystal skull whatsoever. The story of him, and also his daughter, Anna, she has her own stories where after seeing this glint of light through the top of the pyramid, they had lowered her down with a rope. And then because she was the only one small enough to get in there, and she grabbed the crystal skull. That was one story. The other one was that they had her crawl to the side of the pyramid to get the crystal skull. Though that's changed. Also, the bit about them wanting their stuff back, you know, the 1940, where he supposedly bought it at auction. And there was records that he did buy it at auction, but to cover his own reputation or whatever, he said, well, what he did was he gave the crystal skull to someone else and they put it up for auction so that Hedges could then buy it legally and own it to cover his own tracks. Now, Hedges, in the late 1920s and early 1930s, he had written a book about his adventures, which were absolutely fantastic stories in there. And he would recount these stories in his radio show. And everyone loved this radio show. And he had things about him escaping headhunters, fighting giant scorpions. So we're talking like 6 foot tall scorpions, things of that nature. So that gives you an idea where Mr. Hedges comes from. And his daughter, Anna, is no better. She ended up with this skull. And she continually carried it around in a golfing bag for many decades, only allowed certain people to see it, blah, blah, blah. They only did a very cursory examination of the skull when it went to the museum. They did notice in all of the other skulls that they have managed to see that the marks, the circular marks that were made, were compared to other items that had similar etchings and or rubbings or polishings by hand. And they noticed that the grooves in some that were made mechanically were identical to each other side by side, and the grooves that were done by hand, even though a circular motion, were not even, because the pressure of the human hand is different.
Right.
I'm not done.
No, go ahead.
The situation is that at the turn of the last century, Mexico was hewing off huge slabs of quartz crystal, and it was being shipped to to Germany, and the artisans of crystal there in that one city, and a name I cannot pronounce, but they have been making these crystal skulls for centuries, as well as other items out of this crystal they got from Mexico. They still manufacture crystal skulls out of different sorts of things, including onyx and other things. So, you know, it's the idea that he came across this in a pyramid during this excavation is complete crap. His stories are complete crap. His daughter Anna's stories are complete crap, except for what he told her. She could always relate to in the third person, but it was still crap no matter how you looked at it. The whole thing was just garbage.
Right. What I will say about that is...
Take that, Kevin.
No. What I'll say about it is, and I'm not defending it, because to be honest with you, you have to look at it from the standpoint of these skulls. And when you read stories about these skulls, they are an amalgam of stories, right? And that's what I'm saying. Clearly, if you look at the Mitchell Hedges skull, if you did a reconstruction on it, it would be of a European person, not a native. That's true. It doesn't have the features of those different things. Now, that doesn't mean that there's not weird things that happen that show up. In other words, like, for example, this is a good example here. There are swords that the Vikings used called Uthbirch swords. And they were made of a type of steel that they wouldn't make in Europe for 800 years after they were made, right? And so there's a very, very few of these Uthbirch swords. They are made out of what's called crucible steel. It's a thing that a process that they didn't actually even have until the 1800s in Europe. And so, you know, they just couldn't make it. Therefore they exist. And if you ever want to do that, there are copies of the Uthbirch sword. They were either copying the Uthbirch sword back in the Middle Ages, you know. So from 800 to about 1000 BC, they figure roughly about 47 of these swords made, and nobody knows how they did it, and it shouldn't be able to exist. That's the first thing. So I'm saying that from my point, that it doesn't matter to me whether it's a true story or not. All I'm saying is that from the standpoint of that, if you believe that crystalline structures can hold knowledge, like you know what they're trying to do with a hard drive, this whole theory of that, which is what they're trying to do with supercomputers, to be honest with you, is using crystalline structures or crystals to store information. It doesn't really matter where it comes from at a certain point, if, for example, it works. Now, they didn't use it in a circular motion in the way it's like an orbital sander. It was a round, it was an edge-on polishing, like what you'd use on a grinder.
Right.
The difference. Right. There's a difference. So, and the last time that they did that was, I think, about 2018. It was reviewed by the guy at the Natural History Museum, the rock crystal specialist in LA, and that's what he came up with. He didn't compare the two. He just said, yes, it's one piece of crystal. This is where it comes from. You can't tell when it was manufactured, but the theory was that it was made modernly because of this wheel polishing process. It was polished by a wheel. So the weird thing about it was that I will say is, yeah, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense that they would use that in Mesoamerica anyway. But as with the system of the crystal skull and the Uthbirch swords, that the process, which was a Chinese process, somehow these ingots of steel got moved to Scandinavia, and somebody made swords out of them. You see what I'm saying? I'm not saying aliens made it. I'm not saying anything like that made it. I'm just saying stuff.
I'm not saying that it's aliens.
No, it's aliens. I'm just saying
stuff. It's a small world after all.
Yes. Yeah, that's what I'm trying to get at is we don't know much, and we don't know how things end up places.
But we do know how to get to a source of a situation or a story and find out whether it's bullshit or not.
Well, the story might be bullshit. Mm-hmm. That's the truth. But again, if I found something that was out of place or whatever like that, I'm saying don't count something as bullshit just because you can easily say that shouldn't be there, because there are examples in history of things that shouldn't be there. That's my point. My point is I mean, to me, obviously Irish people have been dealing with crystals. I mean, we're known for that, right?
Yeah.
Dealing with lead crystals and everything like that, and that process for a long, long time of shaping stones.
Okay. If you want to say that the artisans of Germany manufactured these crystal skulls and that they have some interesting and unexplained properties to them, I'll go along with that.
Yeah. That's all I'm really trying to say. I'm not trying to say that, you know, it's sort of like this whole idea of
the ghost lights.
Well,
the ghost lights is a great example because of the underlayer of earth, and it comes under these bed of crystals or whatever underneath the earth, causes a great deal of pressure, which causes electromagnetic, which comes up and forms a ball of light.
Yeah, or in the situation of what else? There's lots of that. There's lots of phenomena that happen. Anyway, yeah,
brown lights, whatever.
So.
May I step in real quick?
Yeah, go ahead.
I just want to say I don't really, all the stories aside, kudos to whoever made these skulls, because they're beautiful. And it had to be time consuming, and it had to be a lot of care taken to it, no matter what it does. And they're all beautiful, and it's an interesting story, and praise Thor. Thank you.
Hey Chubbs, let me tell you something. You can still buy these skulls. They still make them.
Yeah.
Cool.
They make them in different sizes. You can have them done in a necklace or whatever you want.
Yeah,
but could they make them back in the 20s and 30s would be the question, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well,
okay.
The thing about great Sphinx and the Great Pyramid of Giza in BCE.
Yeah. E.
Right. Yeah.
And then there's the
Antikythera mechanism. That E all of a sudden. It's not AD anymore either. It's CE. And I don't even know what that is.
That's the current era.
I know. Nobody told me that had changed.
You didn't know that?
No, I didn't know it had changed.
Well, because we can't say Anno Domini anymore.
Yeah, no, I get it. I get it. Yeah. I just, no one had told me. It just.
Yeah. Well, that's a politically correct thing because, you know, obviously, but it doesn't change it whether you say AD or CE.
Wait, real quick. Going back, I want to pull what Richard said. Like every pyramid you see on the earth, that's a great, you know, building. And like the Mexico City, the one with the sun pyramid, they use many different minerals, but shaping a skull exactly with teeth and the eyes and like that.
People weren't stupid, you know.
No,
people,
I didn't say that. Stupid, but
you know, people were just as intelligent as we are today.
Right. They built those pyramids, but to take a piece of crystal had to take a lot of care, and the story of my daughter had to climb through this hole. It's just a nice story. So, but like you said, they can't carbon date it. You know, a rock you have to use by something.
Yeah,
like plants and stuff, but it's cool story. But and now y'all said like his daughter owns the original.
Well, she's dead now. It's her son that owns it now.
She passed away. No, it's her caretaker. Her caretaker when she died.
Oh yeah, you're right. Because he married her.
He didn't marry her.
He didn't marry her. No, I thought he married her.
That's incorrect. That is very incorrect information that's on
there. Oh, no.
Yeah.
I'll have to mark that off my little information.
Yeah, no, he's not married here. And but anyway, but he does take it around and he does show it to different groups and people basically use it as a object of intent to try to bring peace to the world and stuff like mm-hmm. that. But you can see it. And I think I was when we saw it, we were there with the medicine chief of the Blackfeet Confederation. And so, you know, but that's how my wife was invited to go and talk to her about it. But they did find this other part, and mm-hmm. so there is crystal in that cave that they found, and so
thus lies the extended woo of the story.
Yeah. So that's what I'm saying. I mean, from that standpoint, here's the thing from the show. Now here we go.
All right, now we just got to get down inside it.
Right.
All right, here we go. Let's grab some rope.
To get into the cave, we need to do a short rappel through the vertical entrance.
First of all, look at this. Some of the pieces have broken off. Bill, look what's inside of them. Pure crystal.
Pure crystal, wow.
Look at that. So the idea of something being down here carved a crystal, totally possible. Source material is right here.
Sammy said that where the crystal deity was, it was full of tarantulas.
Well,
they did find a tarantula.
Now we just got to get down inside it.
We don't own that.
No, okay. I understand. No, that was a compilation of things. You can use it as copyright for educational purposes.
It doesn't matter. We're not unmonetized. But
no, I'm just
still have to say we don't own it.
Yeah, yeah. It's for educational purposes. And I'm a registered teacher.
But you know what Chubb said is true. Even if it is a load of hooey, they're still incredibly beautiful and intricately carved. Yeah. And you know, that's a cool thing. Nikki, do you have anything to add on crystal skills?
I do not.
Do you want to see it? Do you want to see it, Nikki? Because he lives in Indiana.
You know, if I had a dollar for every time a guy asked me if I wanted to see it.
Hey, you want to come to my place to see my skull carving?
Yes, I would love to see it.
Yeah. Oh, you should, because to be honest with you, it is, when you look into its eyes, you do kind of see the universe. That's all I'm going to say about it, you know. And I'm a woo guy, but it just the way that light draws in and it's focused on certain things like that, it's a weird thing. I mean,
that's really cool. Yeah, no, I would love to see it.
Yeah. I mean, Arthur C. Clarke put it on the top of his show. Remember Arthur C. Clarke?
Oh, there you go, right there.
Yeah.
He was no dummy.
Didn't he invent the geosynchronous satellite?
I think he had a hand in it. I don't know if he personally invented it.
Yeah. Anyway, so, you know, it's one of those things that it's a cool story. You know, and there's always a little bit of doubt in everybody's mind. And I think Mitchell Hedges.
I think I'm happy to wrap up this show on that sentiment. Cool story, bro.
Yeah. Sorry.
All right.
I liked it.
Yeah, no, it was a good story. I enjoyed it. And I enjoyed the Crystal Skull legend, if I don't happen to buy into anything else. So that'll wrap us up for this week. Chubbs, you're up to bat. What would you like to talk about next week?
Would y'all be okay with ghost?
Ghost
story about my trip. I went to the Myrtles Plantation and saw one. It's a very fascinating story.
Stop!
Yeah.
Stop! Don't say anymore. Yes.
Okay. Hell yeah! I love the Myrtles Plantation. It's good stuff.
There you go.
Never heard of it.
I'm so excited.
Yeah.
Is that what I would look up? Myrtle Plantation.
Like the tree, yeah.
Yeah,
Myrtle Tree Plantation.
Pretty famously haunted.
Okay.
So we'll be talking about that, and we'll also be talking about Jerry Freeman, either the greatest archaeologist of the last decade or, well, the last 100 years, or the world's biggest big bullshit artist.
Yeah, but it's like Heinrich Schliemann. Did he really find Troy? Or did he just build a big pit through the middle of an ancient city to try to find stuff?
Right. And Jerry Freeman planted something that supposedly belonged to Helena and said, yeah, this was Helena's.
Well, but this is how we do things. I mean, this is how we justify ancient mythology by naming stuff that we find in other places that we did before.
It's No. It's nothing like that.
No, ancient. All right. I'm just.
You know the story of Jerry Freeman?
No, I don't know. I've never heard of him.
No, well, it's a good yarn. It's a ripping yarn.
Where's Mumbles? We got to have Mumbles in here.
Yeah, I'm getting there. I was wrapping the show up. We will just return next week, despite the hopes of many. It's good night from me, and it's good night from the lads and the ladette. No, no.
Good night, everybody.
I do love the outro. Best part of the show.
That's awesome. That's part of the show. Well, we can do the intro on the outro and just.
It's a good outro. You got to give no credit.
No, it is really good.
It's the, you know, Bigfoot speak.
That's exactly Samurai China. Mm-hmm. This ghost sucks.